Well, I first became aware of the existence of pounds people because I had a friend in Stowmarket called Terry, who used to get into a frenzy of excitement each week as Top of the Pops came around because he regarded them as being the ultimate in erotic spectacles. I mean, he was almost, you know, he felt he should be hosed down both before, during and after the Top of the Pops experience.
They were the sort of girls that you wanted to go home with, you know. You never ever did in a million years, but, you know, you wanted to be, you know, with girls like that every Saturday night, instead of the ones I got.
The cultural feeling of the 70s really was certainly on Top of the Pops. It was the glam rock era. We had people like Gary Glitter, the Sweet, Slade. It was a lot of fun.
And Top of the Pops and Pounds People were a way of life. They really were. And you were very uncool if you didn't switch on at 7:30 every Thursday night on BBC One. That's what everybody did.
Pounds People hit Top of the Pops like a large steam hammer.
I came to London in 1966, and that was Swinging London. And there were all these groups of guys, and you know, like the Beatles, and everybody knew their names. But the dancing girls were all sort of, they worked at the talk of the town and places like that, and they had big hair and small dogs, and they all looked exactly alike.
And I was going to become the greatest actress ever. However, I got sidetracked by doing an audition with a girl called Jo Cook for an American choreographer who had just come over here called Gary Cockrell. Gary had been over here with West Side Story, and he decided he liked England so much that he wanted to stay and work here. So he formed his own group, which was called the Beat Girls, which was in conjunction with a program for the BBC Two called Beat Room. Come alive, baby, whole lot of shit going on. After a few weeks or so, Joe left because of contractual difficulties, and she went on to form this group called the Gojos.
We've got the Gojos dancing here in Top of the Pops. We've got all the Top of the Poppers ready to do the whole bit, and I'm talking about Diana Ross and the Supremes.
Through the mirror of my mind, time after time, I see reflections of you and me, reflections of the way life used to be, reflections of the love you took from me.
When it started out, we were six girls who wanted to work together. Six women who wanted to be liberated and run our own lives, and be in control of our lives. You know, there's... going to an audition is pretty degrading. I mean, just standing there like a meat market. And also what we were trying to do was avoid auditioning because we were saying, this is it, take it or leave it.
So on December the 8th, many years ago, I don't think I'm going to mention the year, Flick and myself and Babs broke away and decided we'd form Pounds People. But we didn't yet have the name.
I wanted to call us Dionysus Darlings, but it was too long. So we decided Pounds People. He's our patron.
We were desperate to work on television.
But in those days, it was a very close shop. It was a choreographer would be hired to do a program, and then he would hire his dancers. And I think what was innovative about Pan's People is that we wanted to be like a little company.
We wrote some very pretentious brochures that we sent round to long-suffering BBC directors explaining dance on television and use of the camera and all this kind of stuff.
And we met Colin Charman. I think he was directing at that time. So we told him all about Pan's People and begged him to come along and see us rehearse and show him the sort of things we were doing, which he did. And eventually that paid off, and we got a chance to do Top of the Pops.
In the treehouse here we lay, above the blue sea spray.
First appearances weren't regularly every week, they were once every fortnight or possibly once a month. For the first 3 months, I think it was.
Gradually, we did a little more and a little more. Instead of being on every month, we were on every fortnight.
And I think it was getting clear to the sort of hierarchy of Top of the Pops that Pan's People was becoming a very integral part of the show.
Top of the Pops was a chart show, and you had to cover the top 10 records or the top 30 records and make a show out of it. But quite often, the singer wasn't available, and there was no such thing as video, so the only thing left was either those globular lights or us, and we were much more fun.
An appeal because everybody was very interested in the clothes, in what we were going to do, what we were doing next week. We certainly knew from the fan mail that came in, we knew that what we were doing was becoming popular, but I don't think we realised quite the impact that it had.
Oh, Tar, thanks very much, Larry. Of course, I really wanted to be an air hostess or one of Pan's People. But meanwhile, I'm working at the builder's yard.
Yeah, well, you have to compromise a bit, don't you?
Yeah. Still, you never know, I might meet interesting people.
Yeah. Gary Glitter might come in for a brick.
I remember when I first became conscious of my popularity. It was when the guy who was checking out the tall blonde in front of me at the supermarket said, "You're pretty enough to be in Pan's People." And I was standing right behind her, and he didn't even recognize me.
If you're keen, we could go out, you know. Oh, yeah, I could ring up a couple of birds, you know. A couple of them darlings that dance on Top of the Pops, you know what I mean? What they call Pan's People, yeah. There's one special one, Beautiful Babs. I don't know what her name is.
see it through. Life can be short or long. Love can be right or wrong.
We had some weird fan mail. Again, I think I've glad I was naive, I didn't really realise what it was all about.
I've actually got a letter here from one of my fans, which I can read out if you want me to, because some of them you can't read out. Dear Louise, I love you. I think you're the best looking person in the world. Please take an interest in this. I am not just one of those 1,000 of fans of yours. I am the top fan. I love you. Please write back to me. It would boost my confidence for the City and Guilds electronics exam.
Oh, I love you. I hope I. Ooh, hey, hey. Liberty, love and high. Yeah, hey, hey. If I lost you, would I cry? Oh, 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 I love you, baby. Baby.
I never really liked performing. I was always the one that went wrong because I was in the middle of the routine thinking, I couldn't have done it this way. I must have done it that way or something. And I was always worried about where the cameras were and if it was being shot correctly and things like that.
And it got to the point where Flick just couldn't cope with being choreographer and dancer. So I think it was actually when we started doing the Bobby Gentry series that she actually gave up dancing, and it just became the five people, which people really tend to remember the most.
Ain't no sunshine when she's gone. It's not warm when she's away. Ain't no sunshine when she's gone, and she's
When we first started Top of the Pops, we signed this ridiculous contract saying that we shouldn't get married. There's a picture of us all in wedding outfits doing that, saying Pan's people have vowed not to get married, you know, us looking innocent. And Andrew Rutherford said, sod that, I'm getting married. So she got married and became pregnant.
When Andy left the group, we had to find a replacement for her, so we held an open audition.
It was in a massive big building, and it was just swarming with girls trying to be Pan's people.
And there were girls packed and winding all the way down the stairs, all the way down to the basement. And I thought, what am I doing? This is awful and frightening, and what is this? And hours later, it was my turn.
There was this little face, and we just thought, and all this beautiful hair, and there was Cherry. We thought, that's the one. She's a fantastic dancer. And so we chose little Cherry.
We were very democratic. It wasn't really like a choreographer and a dance group. I mean, we all made group decisions. So, obviously, if they all wanted one person, unless she was a dog, I wasn't going to say absolutely not. And I thought they were right. I absolutely agreed with their decision.
I've got you the most beautiful Christmas present. It's over there.
Really?
Right? I bet you can't guess. I bet you can't guess what that is. It cost me an absolute fortune. How about that? That's Cherry, and she is going to be the brand new dancer with Pan's people.
She came out of this package, and she just looked adorable. And then we because we were used to cover a piece of music that they didn't have coverage for, we really got some inappropriate stuff.
The scene was rocky, all were digging the sounds. Igor on chains, backed by his baying hounds. The coffin bangers were about to arrive with their vocal group, the Crypt Kicker Five.
They played the mash.
They played the Monster Mash.
The Monster Mash.
It was a graveyard smash.
They played the mash.
It caught on in a flash.
They played the mash.
They played the Monster Mash.
And then there was one really unfortunate Christmas where I think we did something with dogs. And dogs are not good performers. Not, well, these dogs weren't. They just, they smelled and they were old and they were tired. And it was really unpleasant.
At that time, Top of the Pops, perhaps it always has done, was going through its sort of literal period where they would interpret, whenever, you know, Pan's people were on there, they would interpret the words of any song absolutely literally. And, of course, I can't remember any examples of this, but I always do that, you know, I'm looking over a four-leaf clover, which they never did, of course, but, I mean, it was that sort of school of
it had to be because of the time. The time element was a big problem. The Top of the Pops was recorded weekly, and quite often we would get the number that we were going to do the next week on Friday, and we recorded on Wednesday, but on Tuesday the number would drop and we'd have to start over again.
We went through a whole period where we called it frisbees, because suddenly the PA would come and say, I'm sorry, and here's the record you've got to do, and Flick would just very calmly walk over to the record player, pick up the single that was dead, and just frisbee it across the room, and the next one would go on.
But if you look at the difference between the choreography of other shows we did in Top of the Pops, the other shows are more complicated because we had more time and to devote to the choreography and the whole routine.
Getting up and looking down the television like that to try and see farther down the top of Babsy's dress when she used to come up in big close-ups. I mean, to try and see more of her firm, ample chest. And I mean, to this day, I still don't actually know why it didn't work. You know, you get up there like that and you're looking down. And I don't know, I just remember doing that. I was only about 25.
We were definitely more overtly sexual than we realised at that particular time in our lives because, and I think part of the reason is because being trained as professional dancers, you're trained to interpret the music. And a lot of the music is very sexual, so therefore you can't come on doing step ball change to some raunchy record like Tina Turner Nutbush. I mean, it would just look ridiculous. A church house, gin house, a school.
I was having such fun, it didn't occur to me, but I kept getting letters from Miss Bush, who trained me, kept saying things like, Cherry, I do hope this is not, you know, you're not, what's the word, betraying your integrity as a performer.
You're gonna be a long weekday.
I think we were always aware that we were six sexy girls, and I certainly wouldn't deny it. We had a kind of innocence that made it possible for us to get away with that. We liked being six sexy girls, if you really want me to be honest. I mean, it was a heck of a lot of fun.
Although there was a sexuality, there was an innocence behind what we did. We didn't go out to hurt or deliberately to offend. And although some of our costumes may have seemed very skimpy, it was done in a simple, kittenish way.
I mean, I think our skimpiest costume that Louise and I actually wore was on our In Concert.
And the costume was the most expensive costume the BBC had ever paid for us to wear. And it was the smallest thing you've ever seen in your entire life. I decided to leave Pans because I had fallen in love. That was my basic reason. And you cannot have, certainly not in my opinion, certainly not with a job like being one of Pans' people, to give 100% to your job and also 100% to your relationship.
I suppose we all knew it was probably the beginning of the end, as far as the group was concerned.
I was beginning to get those feelings that, you know, it wasn't going to be a career that would go on forever and ever and ever. A dancer's career isn't.
I think we knew it was time to finish then. And also, you know, we were getting on. You know, I mean, I was 30 when we retired, or just about to become 30. And the camera's not always so kind. You have to be able to take a good old close-up.
The overall memory of Pan's people is halcyon days. I think it's that we had tremendous energy, we were doing something we loved to do, and we didn't really understand how it all worked. And the older I get, the more complicated life gets, and the more you question your motives and why you do things. And I don't think we did. I think we just had a wonderful time. Thank you.
It must have broke your poor little heart when the boys used to say you look better in the dark.
Disco dancing from John Travolta and Company in Saturday Night Fever in just a moment.
Give all they learned in school to be somewhere in the dark with you. Oh yes, they would. Holy girl, she was so lonely. Set.